Say, this is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
And I believe the Word of God.
Grace and peace. Grace and peace. We thank God tonight for each and every one of us that's in the room. We are so grateful. We want to come to, the Bible says, two or three touching the group, and we have God in the midst of us. Amen. And we're so grateful for what God is doing. Amen. And we thank God for tonight. We know that this is our Bible class night, and we are so elated. For each and every one of you that are tuned in, amen. And we are grateful for what it is that God is doing and what God is doing. Today we want to talk about the choice. Maybe we can turn there. The choice. The wisdom choice. And we know that a lot of times what we do is we see things and we look at things and not really pay attention to what things are. So when we look in we look into the scripture and we see so much that's going on, so much that God is trying to do, God wants to do, God has a desire to do. Amen. God wants to shift us into an attitude. Amen. And I'm grateful for all the shifting and everything that He wants to do in us and through us. In this hour. So let's go to the Word of God. Amen. Father, we thank you. We praise you. We magnify you. We glorify you. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory. We thank you for what you're doing and how you're doing it. We give you praise, glory, and honor in the precious name of Jesus the Christ. We thank you for what you're doing in us. Give us the tongue of the learned. Give us the tongue of this season. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. All right, let's go to 1 Kings, and I think it's the third chapter. 1 Kings, the third chapter. 1 Kings, the third chapter, that is so profound, because this is a time where Solomon is getting ready to establish his wisdom among the people. He's getting ready to establish his wisdom. And when we look at Solomon and look at all the things that Solomon have done and is doing, we'll find there's a difference in some things, how Solomon and David's reaction. But because of his father, David, Solomon had a lot of favor. When we look in the Bible in 1 Kings, we'll find that there was King Hiram, which was friends of David. He was well acquainted with David. And when he heard that Solomon was had became king, he took all of his officials and came and to have a conversation with Solomon to help him establish. I want to say something to us in the body of Christ that a lot of time what we don't do and what we are failing in is because we want to be a part of the kingdom, but we don't want to be a part of God's official part of the kingdom. Now, that's going to get across to everybody, because you know everybody got their own plan, their own desire. But King Hiram, heard that David was, that Solomon was actually now king. And when he heard that Solomon was now king, he decided, because of my friendship with David, let me go and help David's son establish. Why? Governmentship. Why? It's because someone that's already been on a throne must always be able to empower someone that's coming onto a throne. We look at our presidency today that we live in. Donald Trump was the only president that did not want the five existing presidents to coach him, because that has been the history of our presidency. If when a president comes into forum, the last five presidents will come and begin to come together and mentor him and talk to him, and not just mentor him, but also to watch over the laws that they have already set in place. And because sometimes they'll say, listen, don't change this now.
Because if you change this, I'm telling you what's going to happen, because I'm not in office anymore. And because of that, we find ourselves discombobulated and disorientated. It's because we do not find ourselves in the place of what? Of kingdom requirement, kingdom order. Amen. So when we look at wisdom, wisdom is the quality of having experience. What is wisdom? Wisdom is the quality of having experience, knowledge, and good judgment. The quality of being wise. What is wisdom? Is the quality of having experience. So you know, you hear a lot of times you hear people say, well, wisdom is the principle of a thing. But watch this. Yes, but wisdom is experience. You cannot deplete wisdom experience out of being wise. That's why we have such a major problem in the body of Christ, is because what we have is unexperienced people trying to give consultation. They're trying to counsel, and you don't have no experience. You have never started a church before. And now all of a sudden, you know how to run a church. You have not even been, we have people that have been in church, watch this, but not been a part of the church. That's the difference. When you're in church and not a part of the church, a part of the church doing, I'm doing everything in my power to keep it alive. Being active. Going to church, I just go. I don't pay attention to the announcements. I don't pay attention to nothing that's going on. I just go. So because you just go to church, then you're not a part of the church. You just are a church goer. That's why I don't care to stay in church people. I don't like church people. I tell you that all the time. I don't like church people. I like Christians. Church people just go to church. They're church goers. They go to church because they can't fit nowhere else. No, they just don't fit nowhere else. Don't nobody else want to be bothered with them. So they come to church. It's because a church is the only place where I have validity. Just like some people go to school all their life. So the Bible says to add knowledge to your faith. Don't replace your faith with knowledge, but add knowledge to your faith. So where's the problem comes in when we're not adding knowledge to our faith? All we got is faith. But when we got knowledge and faith, we got a movement. And so if you don't put knowledge with faith, then all you got is faith. But the scripture teaches us faith comes by hearing, and hearing the word of God, which is knowledge. So if you don't have knowledge, then can we really say you got faith? No, because you don't have faith, because faith comes by hearing. So you can have faith in many facets. Yeah, you can get practical faith. You can have faith in many facets. You can have faith in your car, faith in your within your income, faith in your own personal wisdom, a faith in this chair. That's it. Faith in the fact that when you got in here, you sat in that chair, it was gonna hold you. But that's not God's faith. That's self-conditioned faith. See, Solomon went beyond self-conditioned faith. He went to faith that causes wisdom to be activated. So wisdom is, once again, y'all help me say it with in this room. I don't know why the rest of them ain't here, but however, a wisdom meaning is the quality of having experience. Say that. Wisdom is the quality of having experience, knowledge, and good judgment. The quality of being wise. I'll repeat it one more time. The quality of having experience. Or let's say it like this. So y'all, while y'all writing and stuff, let's say it like this. Wisdom is to have experience.
Wisdom is to have experience.
Knowledge. And good judgment.
And good judgment.
That's wisdom. That's wisdom. All right. So that part is wisdom. The quality of having experience, knowledge, and good judgment. The quality of being wise. Right? So, all right. So when we look at that, we look at wisdom. We look at wisdom. Then we go to the scripture. Let's go to the scripture. Let's go to the scripture. Proverbs 5. Proverbs 5. When you have Proverbs 5, and then I think we can do Proverbs 5 and 1. Let's go to Proverbs 5 and 1. Because we're talking about wisdom choice. Wisdom choice. Somebody say that with me. Wisdom choice.
Wisdom choice.
Wisdom choice. Say it again. Wisdom choice. So in other words, what I'm saying is, I'm going to show you in 1 Kings. Wisdom made the choice that had literally elevated Solomon to a place that shocked the whole nation. Your wisdom's supposed to shock nations, not devastate nations.
Wow.
Come on, Edwin, I need you to write this down for me in there, in the stream. In the stream, your wisdom supposed to shock nations, not devastate nations. When you have a wisdom choice and it's in wisdom, it will shock, it will bring, it'll amaze, it will illuminate, right? It will illuminate because wisdom choice is better than your choice.
That's right.
All right, Proverbs 5 and 1 says what?
My son, attend unto my wisdom.
And my son, attend unto my wisdom. Now, Proverbs, we understand that Proverbs is written by who? Solomon. We understand the Ecclesiastes is written by what? Solomon. We understand that the Song of Solomon is the stories and all that Solomon had been through. But watch this, what's amazing that some of us don't understand and don't know, Benita, that Proverbs and Ecclesiastes was written because Solomon wanted the people to understand how he messed up.
Wow.
No one really sit down and discuss with us why Proverbs and Ecclesiastes was written. It was written as the book of wisdom, and it was also the book of saying, listen, let me explain to you, let me write down these, let me notate these wisdom to help you not to become or to do what I did.
Wow.
Why, Solomon was a man that had 1,700 wives, right? And 300 concubines. That's 1,000 women. Right. What did God say, Mother Cortina? What did God say, Benita? RJ, what did God say? He says, God says to Solomon, in all that you become, don't you take the strange women unto your kingship. And where Solomon messed up was, not only was he wise, but he was not wise enough to make the right choice to not do what all the other kings was doing. Let's back up, RJ. Let's back up all the way. Let's back up all the way. Why I personally feel like once you get married one time, it should be one and done. That's just my, this is not Bible. I didn't say this was Bible. I said my, what did I say? Oh, y'all talk to me. My, thank you. My personal opinion. Because when God pulled that woman out of Adam, what did he pull? A woman. Thank you. He pulled one woman out of Adam. He didn't pull a multifaceted of women out of Adam because every Adam got its wife in there.
Right.
And I'm going to leave that alone. And every wife is inside her Adam. I'm going to leave that alone because what we have done is literally came outside of the realm of God to create our own environment and our own lifestyle. And now we find ourselves so discombobulated and disoriented, and now we have to disconnect ourselves from covenants that God did not give us to be a part of. Are you hearing me? And then Paul gives us some what? He gives us some precise instructions concerning marriage and concerning things. Paul even, he also gives us instructions on how to be single. Right? I'm a firm believer. You're not ready for marriage if you don't know how to, if you don't understand being single. If you can't be by yourself for a few moments until God perfect you, or that God perfect the person that's ordained for you. I don't want nobody that's not perfected for me. and perfected for the purpose in my life. As we can foretell and foresee how many people that we have came in contact with that have become so discombobulated and disoriented because of the wrong connection. Paul told us to do something in scripture. He said what? He said the writer said what? And in the New Testament he said, don't be unequally yoked.
Right.
Come on, with unbelievers. Not. See, some people think he's just talking about the unbelievers like the sinner man. There are some people that are Christian but don't believe like you believe.
Right.
And so my Muslim friend called me yesterday. So I have a Muslim friend. And my Muslim friend called me yesterday and said, brother, what you doing? I said, I ain't doing nothing. He said, first he said, shalom. I said, do y'all supposed to say shalom? And I'll be messing with him. And he said, I said, I thought you supposed to say Astalama Lega Lega Lakalama. And he said, see, there you go. You always messing with me, and I don't mess with you Christian people. I said, but here's the problem. I love messing with you. It's because it let me see exactly where your Muslim faith is. See, us Christian folks, if you get to mess with us, we get to cuss me out. Well, that's wrong. That's all I'll say. That's anybody. So, but I always watch him that don't care what I do, he stay on track with what he believes, right? So we was talking about the scripture yesterday. We were talking about Solomon yesterday. And he was sharing some good wisdom to me yesterday. I said, man, I said, the people are not ready for this right now, but I'm going to take this and keep soaking it in. Well, so he called me. He said, your birthday's coming up. I said, yeah, my birthday's coming up. He said, so what you planning on doing? And I said, oh, I don't know. He said, well, come on by and let me see. You tell me what you want so I can put it back to the back and I won't get rid of it. And so I went. I really feel for the first time, I didn't really see nothing that I wanted. I didn't see nothing that I wanted to wear. You understand what I'm saying? And he had a lot of nice things. I just didn't see nothing I wanted to wear. But walking away, wisdom said choice. Wow. And I thought about it today. I said, tomorrow when I get to Bible class, I'm going to talk about wisdom's choice. Even though there was some wonderful things, and I'm going to get an amazing discount from this brother, right? But wisdom choice said, don't. Maybe down the road I get a better discount, or maybe I don't need it this time, Benita. Right? But first thing, Proverbs 5 and 1 says, he says what?
My son, attend unto my wisdom.
My son, attend unto my wisdom. And whose wisdom?
The wisdom that Solomon said.
Attend it. No, read it again.
My son, attend unto my wisdom.
Uh-huh.
And bow thine ear to my understanding.
Mm-hmm.
That thou mayest regard discretion, and that thy lips may keep knowledge.
Now you got yours, RJ,
yes,
mother. What translation you have today? What translation you have today?
Common English Bible.
Common English Bible. What Proverbs 5:1 says in your Bible?
My son. Pay attention to my wisdom.
See, Paul. This is Solomon. Solomon is talking to the people to pay attention to his wisdom. Not God's wisdom, his wisdom. Because he wants to explain the devastation that can happen when you don't follow the wisdom of leadership or the wisdom of the order that God has set over our life. Solomon is an amazing teacher. But we always talk about how powerful and how wise he is. Or how wise he was, right? Because he's a past tense wisdom. His wisdom ain't now. He, even though the Bible said, mother, that Solomon was the wisest man, right? And the riches, right? But watch this. But today somebody would beg to differ with me and you and say that there's more riches people today and more wiser people today. But I'm going to stick to the wisdom of God and say, you see, watch this, Benita. God's wisdom is far different from the world's wisdom.
Right.
That's why, y'all, we cannot compare the word or mix the world wisdom with God's wisdom. What did the scripture tells us, RJ, about the new wine and the old wine? He said you can't put the new wine in the old skin. Why, mother? Because I did a talk, a research on that. So when you put new wine in the skin begins to stretch to the wine because the wine continues to
ferment.
It fermentates, breathe, and it begins to expand. Right, it's expanding the bag, the bag that it's in. So as I was searching for Nina, it says if you put new wine in the old skin that has already been fermented and breathed by the old wine, the new wine will cause it when it starts breathing and fermenting, it's going to cause it to burst. and you lose, watch this, you lose the content of what you put in something old. That's why, watch this, y'all. I need y'all to catch this. That's why you have to allow, when Jesus said, let the old and the young, or the scripture said, let the young and the old worship together. Because there is an oil that is a wisdom, not an oil. There is a wisdom you have that's different from the wisdom that RJ is going to get. Right, watch this, but watch this. We can't say that part, mother. I can't say that your wisdom is so important and relevant. Jesus, the generation after you, which is me and after me, would say your wisdom is weak. But no, watch this. God says, I call the old because they know the way.
That's right.
He said, I call the young because we're strong. Our wisdom is weak. The new generation wisdom is the weak wisdom. Because we have not been experienced.
Yeah.
Remember what I gave y'all the definition. Wisdom is experience, which is knowledge and good judgment. So our case, wisdom is not strong yet because it hadn't been tested. But your wisdom has been tested. Like the other day when we were talking about the choo-choo train. And you made a statement. You said the caboose is far better, is more needful than the engine. Because it keeps everything together, right? But how many young people like myself and RJ, all we know is what? We see the choo-choo, choo-choo. What are we afraid of? Choo-choo, choo-choo. And every time we pass, we see a choo-choo stuck on the road with all the tanks behind them with no caboose. And I thought about that the other day when I was going down Main Street. And it was the Main Street. Lee Street, Main Street by the train station, the train was stuck right there. All they had was an engine and no caboose. I said, Mother was right, but where is this caboose? Please somebody find the caboose. Guess where the caboose was? Way down the street. It was disconnected from the train way down the street, connected to another portion of the train, right? So in other words, the general wisdom would never be weak. It's our wisdom that's weak, and we need the feeding, and we need the nurturing, we need the impartation of the generals of the faith. Are y'all hearing me? So guess what? My wisdom compared to your wisdom is weak, but your wisdom is not, because the Bible says, I call the old because they know the way. No, K-N-O-W, which is the four-letter word, and you put ledge on the end, it's called knowledge. Right? So if we break that word up, know brings knowledge, because you know your wisdom is not irrelevant. It is relevant.
Right.
It's relevant for this. Nor is it weak. So I can't let you say that. It's not even weak. It's because if the saints and the generals would sit down, if the generals and the new people would sit down and let the generals talk just a little while, and give a moment of conversation, we'll get more added to our wisdom. See, one thing, watch this, one thing God didn't want to do is put new wine in old skin. Wine doesn't represent wisdom. Wine doesn't represent wisdom. Wisdom comes from the spirit that you and God have. That's why Elisha had a different experience from the sons of the prophets, from the schools of the prophets. Why? Because wisdom is experience, right? It's knowledge and it's what? Good judgment. So watch this. So Elisha said, I'm going to maintain good judgment. I'm going to maintain good judgment, and I'm going to maintain my experiences I'm having with Elijah. And that's why every time they say to Elijah, to Elisha, your Lord is going to be departed. Notice something. Y'all, the schools of the prophets, the sons of the prophets and the school of the prophets say to Elisha, your Lord.
Right.
Y'all missed that. He said, no, watch this. He said, your Lord. In other words, the one that have lordship over the oil and the mantle that's getting ready to be poured on you. Reason why in leadership, where we are so discombobulated and disoriented, and we are double-minded in our leadership, because can't go by lordship over us. Because we won't allow people to lordship over us, but we allow marriage to lordship over us. Notice something, y'all. Can I get a statistic test? How many of us ever say my time is up in a marriage?
Amen.
Yeah.
Now, y'all too old to tell that lying sanctuary. Because, you know, when y'all got married, now, and I don't know, we be open conversation. No, I'm not saying it in a rebukeful way. I'm saying it in a comical way. But my statement, huh? It was what? Right. No, my point. I get what y'all saying and how y'all say it. Because today's society, generation, says, oh, you know, I'm outgrowing my marriage. Yeah. Marriage was never made for you to outgrow it. Marriage was made for you to grow with it.
That's right.
And go in it. Thank you. But see, that same wisdom again. In it and with it, right? So when I hear people say, Prophet Juan, or my writer say, bro, I feel like I outgrew my marriage. No, you didn't outgrow your marriage. You said in covenant for better or for worse, sickness and in health, as richer or poor, until death do us part. So if that's the statement, why are we all in divorce, in our divorces, and in our relationship? Because you know why? We treat marriage like we treat the relationship that was in. Some of us treat the relationship like it was about nothing, and when we got in marriage, all we wanted was benefits and a name, so we get a social minority, like Mother Critique would say, a social minority. And some folks got married in the olden time because it was the right thing to do, and then, you know, that was our custom. You know, I look at my grandmother, I look at your mom and dad. Your dad died, and mother became a widow, right? And did she ever remarry again? She never remarried. But your mom is how old now?
95.
Your mom is 95 years old. That was her generation. Right. Her generation said no. And whatnot. Your mom passed away first, right? Yeah. But Tyson passed away then. Then Pop Tyson, he got remarried again. He never remarried. Right. But your mom didn't.
And my dad broke his neck.
So your mom never remarried. Never remember. So that's what I'm trying to say. See, the wisdom, those people said, listen, I join in. Mother Dr. Betty Ransom Nelson, she made a statement when Bishop Nelson closed his eyes. And that was a young man that preached at Pastor Tracy's church, his mom. His dad closed his eyes. His mom stood up and she said, the dad to him, baby, you can go on and do thus and so. And Mother Nelson said to her husband, she said, listen here. She said, I'm a sanctified woman. She said, I'm a sanctified woman. All I needed was you. And you're gone. And she said, I'm gonna live until good Lord called me. You and I be together again. Why? You see, you understand? Because that generation of wisdom, that all of wisdom of y'all day said, no, we're dedicated to the cause. And not only that, but in Christendom, that's the same kind of dedication God wants with us. To be so dedicated to the cause that we will say, listen, I know what society is saying, but because I'm not a part of society, I'm a part of Christendom, then I must operate differently than society. Listen, I've never been married, but I'm married to this church. I'm married to the church of the living God. Are you hearing me? I don't care who comes or going, I'm staying at the sacred desk of God. Why? Because I'm married to this assignment that I didn't even want, Mother. I didn't want to be a pastor. I did not want to be a preacher, Benita. I just wanted to keep my daddy alive. I just wanted my daddy to be strong and empowered and to be rich with wisdom and more oil so he could keep pouring it into us. And by that chance, daddy looked over and said, the light of the cast is you and it. And many people say, well, why would he die? Why did you let it go? Because when someone trusts you, when God have anointed you, oh my God, to look at a dying man full of wisdom, and that man take your right hand and put under his right thigh, and then anoint your right ear, your right eye, and then make you get in the bed and anoint your right big toe. Come on here. And then anoint your right thumb and tell you you are it, son. You must pursue, and without a fail, you will recover all. I am persistent in this walk with God because my daddy anointed me for the walk, and not because I wanted it. He anointed me, and his wisdom told me this was the right choice to make. And guess what? I don't care who don't like me and who don't like what I say. I'm standing on what God told me to do. Listen, I don't care if I got one person or a phone that I got to talk to until God called me home. I am going to stay dedicated because that's the wisdom choice for my life.
I know that's right.
What daddy did for you,
he anointed body parts of his temple. See, people don't realize when he anointed that big toe, that big toe is essential.
Yes, but that's custom.
But it's a stabilizer too.
Right, and that's the truth. It's a stabilizer that keeps you balanced. And thank you for that wisdom. See, that wisdom. Because, and watch this. And watch this. That was so imperative and so important for me in my wisdom choice is because my daddy will always give me wisdom. He would sit me down and talk to me. And there you go. You know why daddy talked to me? Because I'm listening. It was 70 elders in our church. Six out of them gone. Are you hearing me? I'm telling you, all 70 elders that was ordained and licensed and laid hands and anointed and they laid on the floor and we covered them with sheets and daddy took oil and poured oil on top of the sheet and then wrapped the sheet back up and handed back to them and said, this is your prayer cloth. This is what you come up and pray. This is what you go in your prayer room and you come up. This is what you lay up with and you talk to God in the wee hours of the night. Don't let nobody sleep on that. Don't wash it. Don't do all of that. He said, just keep it together and put it away in a sash. He said, because this is what God told me. He told me to anoint your sheets and give it back to y'all. Daddy laid us on the floor. When I was the last one, Daddy laid 7 layers of sheets on top of me. Oh, shit. Oh my God, daddy laid 7 layers of sheets on top of me and anointed each corner of the sheets, each corner beneath of the sheets, and they laid them on top of me. And finally, when it got to the last one, he took the oil and turned it upside down in the center of the sheet and let the oil saturate all the way down to my body. Are you hearing me? My God, today, because daddy told me, he said, you got dimensions that these other elders ain't gonna go to. But Benita, I didn't see it. I didn't see the dimension. I didn't feel the dimension. I wanted to be a model. I just wanted to keep my daddy alive. I just wanted my daddy to still be alive and strong. But what my wanting for him may turn God's desire on for me. Oh my God, listen here, somebody. I'm going to say that again. Maybe somebody can catch this on Facebook Live. Somebody in this room can catch this. What I wanted turned on God's desire faucet for me. And God started pouring his oil on me. And daddy kept pouring and daddy kept pouring. And in all the losses and all the loss I've had, I'm still standing with a brokenness in heart and contrite of spirit. I'm still standing. Why? Because I was anointed for this time. And I was anointed to have a wisdom child. Come on. That's why Proverbs 5:1 said, he said, listen to my wisdom. Come on.
And bow thine ear to my understanding.
Listen, he said, look what Solomon said to those that would listen to him. That's right, Mother Benita, listen to me. Out of 70 elders, I went to daddy's house every day. And 70 elders, I cleaned up his front yard and the kitchen coop every day. For 70 elders, I made sure his trash was to the front and still get on the bus and take a long journey back home. And everybody was at home. Johanna and Donkers and Bunny and Junior and Kevin and Ernest and Michael, Ronnie, Malcolm and Butcher, June and Dee Dee and Jack and Kathy. And all it was all outside the house smoking and drinking and having fun and just enjoying their boo nanny, their poor boys and their heart. And I would come home, I'd be overworked from sweat and tired from work. And they'll say, well, where you come from? Somebody would holler with a sarcastic way. Oh, you know he's coming from the business house, John. He's coming from them church people. He's coming from them church people. But it was okay. But I still came and I got dressed and I went to bed. I woke back up to get a long walk to catch the bus to go to work. And I get off of work and go and see about that. Go and see about them. I would call them through the course of the day. Say, how y'all doing? This, this, that, and the third. All of these things. But daddy kept pouring. And when I would give you working and labor in the video, daddy was sitting on the front porch and start talking about the Bible. He was sitting on the front porch and talking to me. And you know why? Because I listened. Not only did I listen, RJ, I made myself available for the message. I made myself available for the lesson. You cannot have wisdom if you don't want to be available.
That's so good. That's right.
Wisdom trust Proverbs 5:1 says what?
5:1 says, my son, attend unto my wisdom, mm-hmm. and bow thine ear to understanding, mm-hmm. to my understanding, that thou mayest regard discretion, and that thy lips may keep knowledge. 3, for the lips of a strange woman drop as a honeycomb, and her mouth is smoother than oil, but her end is bitter as wormwood, sharp as a two-edged sword. Her feet go down to death, her steps take hold on hell.
Pause for a minute. Look what the Bible says in Proverbs 5 and 1 in the CBD verse. My son, if you listen closely. That's what it's about to say.
Yes,
is it, my son, if you listen close, are you hearing me?
Mm-hmm. Bend your ears to what I know.
Bend your ears to what I know. So that you can maim this tree. That's it. And we got too many leaders that think they know everything. Now, you notice something. Watch this, y'all. This is what we're going to be like on Sundays. Right here. Because God want to pour into that. We get to worship it and magnify God. God wants to pour into us. God want to pour into us a new level that he's called. God want to pour us in the new realm of the spirit that he's called us. God want to pour into us the new realm of faith. Come on. The new realm of wisdom and knowledge. Look what he said. He said, my son, if you listen closely to my wisdom and good sense, you will have sound judgment and you will always know the right things to say. You gotta listen.
That's right.
A lot of times, Benita, a lot of times we don't listen.
Right.
Come on, Facebook Live, we don't listen. A lot of us don't want to listen to what God is calling for us. Come on, somebody lay your hands on your head and say, Lord, help my mind.
Help my mind.
Lord,
circumcise
my ears.
That I may hear you.
In the way you're calling me to hear.
In the way that you're calling me to hear.
Now you heard that? The way you God
that's
calling me to hear. Not what society, not what my best friends, not what myself, not what my companions are saying, but God, what it is that you want me to know. Look what he says. Look what verse number 3 says. The words of an immoral woman may be as sweet as honey, but as smooth as olive oil. But all that you really get from being with her is bitter corn. Come on. I don't care. In other words, Solomon's saying, listen, I know what the world gonna tell y'all.
Yeah.
So let me read it again. I read it this way. The words of this sinful world may be as sweet as honey and as smooth as olive oil. But all that you will really get from being with the world is bitter poison and pain. Oh, we can attest in this world that this world has birthed nothing but bitterness and pain. And I hear a lot of Christians say, well, the world, we're not the world, children. We're in it, but we're not of it. We're not, no. We don't do what the world do, baby. We don't, no. He told us to let our light shine in men, and darkness can see our good works.
Right.
Come on, and glorify the Father, which is in heaven. Come on, God, guess what? Our purpose, y'all, on this earth is to glorify God.
Right.
Our purpose, everything about our lives is supposed to glorify God in all things. Are you hearing me?
Yes,
all right, let's go to verse number five.
Number five says, her feet go down to death, her steps take hold on hell.
Mm-hmm.
Lest thou shouldest ponder the path of life, her ways are movable that thou canst not know them.
Mm-hmm.
Hear me now, therefore, O ye children, and depart not from the words of my mouth.
Mm-hmm.
Remove thy way far from her, and come not nigh the door of her house.
All right. Now let's go over to the fourth Proverbs, the fourth chapter.
Number 1:4-1.
Mm-hmm.
Hear ye, children, the instruction of a father, and attend to no understanding. For I give you good doctrine.
Okay, now I got a problem with that. What happens when we don't have a good father? I sound like one of the animated people. I should have been an actor. Isn't it something? Thank you, my goodness. Isn't it something that read it again?
Number one says, my
children listen closely to my teaching and learn common sense. That's what that's your favorite word. You know, that's what Papa used to say all the time. My granddad would say, you know, learn some common sense, child. Because common sense was told you not to do that.
Right.
Why didn't you walk all the way over there when you could just spread down that way? Common sense. And we said, but watch this. I had an auntie who said, but daddy, this was common sense for me. He said, child, it couldn't have been. Common sense don't make you go long way. Common sense make you go the short way. That's common sense.
Common sense is a flower that does not grow in every garden.
flower, as Mother said, that doesn't grow in every garden. But watch this. Listen to this. My children, listen closer to my teaching and learn common sense. What does your Bible say?
Hear ye, children, the instruction of a father, and attend to no understanding. For I give you good doctrine, forsake ye not my law. For I was my father's son, tender and only beloved in the sight of my mother. Number four said, he taught me also, and said unto me, let thine heart retain my words, keep my commandments, and live.
But verse number 5 says,
get wisdom.
Get wisdom.
Get understanding.
Get understanding.
Forget it not.
Forget it not. Wait. That's where Solomon, you see Solomon talking to us? See how Solomon talking to us, Mom? Do you really see that? Proverbs is Solomon's explanation to us of what happened to him in 1 Kings. God told that booger, will you go and become the king? Do not take these silly and uncouth women and be. He told them especially, don't take the daughters of the Sidonians. Out of everybody, the Sidonian wife is the one that encouraged that booger to turn his back on God. And watch this. Thank you. That's wisdom, mother. Wisdom tells us you chose what was in you. That's why the scripture tells us what's in your heart, do it quickly. Yes. Because it's already there. See, God's not going to tell you what's not in your heart. If it's already in there, you've already sinned. See, the scripture said if the eye has caused you to sin, by seeing it, cast it out. Huh? Right? In other words, what the scripture was really saying is remove your vision from that. He wasn't really saying pull your eye out. He was simply saying turn your vision away from that. Right. Direct your vision to something that whatsoever things are pure, just, and of a good report, think on these things. Huh? Right? Is that the end of praise? Think on these things. Look on these things. Touch these things. But we don't. Come on. We look, and today I was at the store getting me some ice. And this girl walked in, you know, she had a spandex dress on. I'm sitting in the car. I drove up. His brother was coming out with water. And he got in the car, and she got out of her car, was walking. He left. Then he looked back at me, and I'm just standing like this. I said, what did I say?
Do you think you can get him? He said, no, bro, that's too much for me. That rump too much. The way she's dressed too much. That car she's driving too much. I ain't got the money for it. I said, well, you should have kept your comments to yourself. The only comment for what you can afford.
Wow.
And what you can't afford, you leave it alone. Yeah. Leave it alone. Because guess what, brother? You done already opened your door.
Right.
No. I said, you had opened your door. And now you're going home and laying with your girlfriend. Right. And the first thought in your mind is going to be her with her. And that's so messed up.
That is.
He looked at me like, how you just thought that? Because I just said, I bet what I'm going to do. Dude, that's life. People do that. People fantasize off of other people with the people that they're with.
That's right.
You know you can't get Beyonce, so you got Neonce. So while you got Neonce, you're going to be making love to Neonce, but in your mind, you're going to be making love to Beyonce.
It's somewhere else.
You know, that's a blues song, isn't it? Come on, it's your blues song. But however, look what he says. He says, get wisdom, get understanding, forget it not. RJ, is imperative that we maintain the wisdom of God.
That's right.
Neither decline from the words of my mouth. Look what he, come on, read it, girl.
Get wisdom.
Uh-huh.
Forget it not.
Uh-huh.
Neither decline from the words of my mouth.
Now, RJ, what did Proverbs 4:5 say for you?
Proverbs 4:5 in the CEVDCR version says, be wise and learn good sense.
Be wise, learn good sense.
Remember my teaching. And do what I say.
So every leader has to have a leader over them.
That's right.
And if you fail to operate under good leadership, you're going to operate as a bastard. And every prophetic word, let me tell you something. The Bible says you bring forth seeds of your own kind. If your heart is of a bastard, guess what? All you're going to attract is bastard prophets.
on, sir.
If your heart is angry with people, you mad with folks, and you upset with folks, and you ready to dismiss people out of your life, everybody coming to talk to you is going to talk to you about what your heart is about. Why? Because that's what you put before the people, before the prophets. Right. And now prophets today have been made out of psychics. And so they stand up and say, no. I want to tell you this, because this is what I deserve from your heart. But wisdom says, no, you need to go home and get that right. Before God can do anything, go home and get that mess right. Because nothing is going to come out of that foolishness and that drama that you're creating.
Come on, sir.
Come on. Well, we don't do that because most of the prophets, today I do deliver, right? So I went to go pick up a package from Green Rock, the beauty supply place, right? So now they use this, now they're trying to put children in my car. I'm going to opt from that point. You ain't putting nobody's kid in my car. Wisdom chart saying you're not getting in my car, right? I don't care what you say. Now, so I walked into the place to go and get the package, and the day they had the package all packed up, I gave it, I showed it to her, and she said, yeah, this is the name, and you know, all this stuff, right? Okay, so I'm walking out, right, and I run into the prophet of God, and he says, and I'm being nice about the prophet of God, so he said, when I went in, I saw who he was. So, Lord. And I got my thing, and I was going to walk out the door. So I eased my way up when I let them. Prophet, what? I didn't know it's man of God. And y'all know how I don't like that in public. You know, I don't like that in public. Right? Because sometimes people be trying to be shady with me.
Right.
Oh, yeah.
And then they make me see my wisdom charts, not yeah, Solomon wisdom charts, will make me slap one. So, or ignore them, and then they'd be really offended because I ignored them. You heard me call, no, I didn't hear you call. That day I didn't hear you. Me and the Lord was talking while you was calling, yeah. But, however, he hollered, and I turned around, I said, hey, brother. Just like, hey, brother, how you doing? And he was talking, and just going on talking, blah, 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 I said, all right. I said, well, you got my number, brother. He said, no, I need to release this word to you right now. I said, no, you don't need to release that word to me right now. I said, because I have dealt with my issues, and I'm dealing with the others that's not been dealt with. I don't need your prophetic word. Well, the problem is you've been watching my lives. And because you don't see certain people, you question it, and you're trying to be a prophetic, a prognosticator. I said, but I'm good with that. I'm good with that. I'm moving on, right? So, and a lot of people lately have been saying, well, I've been inviting, you're not showing up, and you got a problem with me? No, I don't have a problem with you. I'm just in a wisdom choice.
That's right.
Yeah. I'm just in a place where God has me, because I don't want you to try to prophesy or lie to me or tell me something, right? And watch this. I'm in a place where God needs me. Feel the same thing with God, but I'm in a place of wisdom. God, pour more wisdom. Give me what I need and what I desire. Right. You know, because, and then the first, before we got ready to leave, yeah, you know, man, God, I was watching live, and he got ready to start talking about a certain person. I said, no, you're not going to do that. You're not going to do that. I said, no. Because anybody know me, I'm going to talk about my church.
I know that's right.
You're not going to do that to me. I don't care what they do to me behind my back, I'm not letting y'all do it. And I can be a witness today, as many people have been in this ministry, and many people that know this ministry that will come to try to talk about people that's in this ministry or I've left this ministry, I always put it at home. I don't let my family talk. I don't let no one say anything about the members of this church. Why? Because it's a seed.
That's right.
And if you let that seed be planted, the moment the enemy caused chaos, that seed will grow in the chaotic moment.
That's right.
And it become worse and worse. Right. Be wise. Learn good sense. Remember my teaching. Do what I say. Verse number 6 says what?
Forsake her not,
mm-hmm.
and she shall preserve thee.
Mm-hmm.
Love her, and she shall keep thee.
See? Talk about wisdom. He said, if you love wisdom and don't reject her, she will teach, she will watch over you. I told y'all some time ago that wisdom don't need your voice.
Yes, you do.
Wisdom has a voice. Wisdom don't need your eyes. Did you just see? Did you just not see? Now I want y'all to underline verse number 7. Verse number 6. Underline verse number 6 and remember that wisdom have eyes. Wisdom not only have a voice, but wisdom have eyes. Wisdom have ears. Wisdom have a heart. Oh, y'all ain't saying nothing yet. First number six, that if you love wisdom and don't reject her, she will watch over you. Wisdom have eyes.
That's right.
Yeah. Wisdom has eyes. Wisdom has eyes. Wisdom can see beyond what you saw. Yeah, no, let's go beyond that, because you know why? Some people's mind is so contempt. If I'm angry with you, my wisdom won't work to deal with you. And the purpose of that is, watch this, I'm going to show you something. This is how I can tell a lot of people that operating in wisdom and not operating in wisdom. Daddy told me years ago, he said, son, he said, the reason why I'm always on you about keeping your heart pure, because wisdom can't operate in a contaminated heart. He said, son, the moment your heart becomes so agitated and aggravated with people, you will not be able to lead and operate with people.
Wow.
And he said, this is to me, son. He said, the moment you have a problem, you start having a problem with me, wisdom leave you. Wow. Wisdom never stays with a person that have a problem with one that's imparting wisdom in them. The late Archbishop of Ron Ash said something to me many years ago. As I sat at his foot, not my pastor, but just a mentor, I sat at his foot, because I was pastoring at this time. Didn't have no covering in L.A. I was just sitting there at his feet. And let me tell you something. There was many times, y'all, I was going through in my body, but I would jump in that coffin. And I would go and just sit every Saturday. Just sit. And I remember one time Charlene had asked me, she said, can I come with you? I said, no. And I remember times, I really believe why God poured so much in her, because she never left the scene. When that white car started messing up, Charlene started taking me in her car. She was sitting in that car with her Bible. For however many hours that man had us in there. She couldn't get in there because she wasn't leaving. That is saying, because he only wanted to see you leave to talk to. But she stayed outside the door. She stayed close to the curtains of God.
Wow.
And she said, God, whatever's in there, when he come out, let me get the residue. I remember the man preached to us. He said, I may not be the cup.
Oh, yeah.
The cup. Let me be the saucer. Y'all remember when the man preached that? He said, because what the cup don't hold, the saucer will. Then he talked about the teaspoon. He said, remember this. So Charlene remembered that, and she sat there and she began to seek wisdom and cry out to God for wisdom, and God began to pour into her, because you know why? She dedicated herself to bring me there every Saturday, regardless of how long it was going to mess up her day.
Wow.
How long it was going to mess up her day. And how many times I was just going through, just heard it, and I'm just sitting there, and while I was sitting there, the pain would be so great, but I just buried because I wanted, and we would sit in the inside, and he would just pour on and start talking, and just close his eyes and just walk us through the Bible and say, this is amazing. This is phenomenal. And I never want to miss a Saturday. But I remember one thing he said to us. He said, when you have problem with the imparter, the one that's imparting in you, you lose the ability to have impartation.
Wow.
And he said, when you go somewhere else, because you didn't get it right with the last imparter, the next imparter won't be able to sow into you either.
Wow.
And I asked him why. I said, Archbishop, I said, why is that so? He said, remember. He said, you don't believe me? He said, let's go to Solomon. He said, Solomon was nothing in the eyes of God, nor in the land of the people was nothing. He was of a minute, a being. But God raised him up, huh? Made him a king. But what did he do? He even went when Elisha told him, when the prophet told him what the Lord said. He rejected. Remember? He said, listen, you got to go and slew. This is your assignment. Y'all better hear me tonight as we get ready to close. Hear me. Whatever assignment God gives you, you got to complete.
That's right.
There is no such thing that I'm in the New Testament church that I cannot complete the assignment that God gave me. No, even in the New Testament church, we must complete the assignment that our King gives us. It's imperative that we completed this assignment. No, you don't believe me? What scripture say? The race isn't given to the swift, neither the battle to the strong, but to thee. Come on, you got to complete it. You got to complete it because guess what? The grass ain't green on the other side, sweet darlings. Come on, it ain't better somewhere else. You still got to complete it. Look, he said, Saul. He said, Saul. He said, listen here. He said, go and kill the Amalekites. Destroy, utterly destroy them. He did not fulfill the assignment, and he came home with the king. Came home with the oxen and the sheep. Huh? And what happened? Now the prophet has to get out of position and become a killer and do what the king didn't do. And then what did God say? He said, I remove the throne, the kingdom from you, and gave it to your neighbor. Even when he went to the witch of Endor and wake up the prophet, what did the prophet say? I cannot impart into you anything different. The conversation remains the same. The kingdom has been ripped from your hand. Why? You got to maintain the assignment that God put on you. And don't become discombobulated and disorientated by what other people's assignments are. What God gave the man down the street is not what God gave me. What God gave Pastor Tracy, Pastor Howard, is not what God gave me. I got to stick to the script, what God gave. And God told me to build the kingdom of God in the hearts and the minds of these people. And it's been a mighty battle doing that. But hey, I love God. Because wisdom has and he has eyes. We'll watch over us. Verse number 7 says what?
Wisdom is the principal thing. Therefore, get wisdom, and with all thy getting, get an understanding.
Verse 7 in my Bible says, the best thing about wisdom is wisdom herself. The best thing about wisdom is wisdom herself. Good sense is more important than anything else. Good sense. See, wisdom doesn't make you look at mother or Benito or Archie or you as your current. I have to look beyond your current and find the origin. Wow. You're who you are because of a beginning. There is a beginning that got you where you are. And sometimes we can ignite new direction in people. And that's why scripture said, don't be a stumbling block in your brother's way. Wisdom will tell him, no, let me not do that. Let me pray. Let me see God. Let me cry out to God. Wisdom will say, be quiet. Stand still. Learn something out of here. You're going to learn something out of this. Just shut up. Don't say a word. Don't say a word. Don't argue. Don't defend yourself. Don't do none of that. Just be quiet. Hush your noise. Don't say a word. Just be quiet. Wisdom say be quiet. Wisdom say be quiet. No, because beyond what you see right now, this is what you see now. But this is not the real person. There's something beyond that. There's a hurt. There's a pain. That's a strike that was done. That was a word that was spoken. That was an overheard conversation that knocked that person mentally into a place of backsliding. We look at the backslider, but we don't know what made them backslide.
Exactly.
Maybe it's something I said that made you backslide. Maybe it's something you did, we did, to make each other backslide. And as soon as they take the backsliding space, we get up and we holler and say, oh yeah, they're in the backslide, and I'm getting me and my family away from them. Oh, I'm getting me. No, I'm leaving here. Oh, no, I don't want to be bothered no more. Oh, I'm done with the church. No, them church people. No. You ain't done with your mama. Your mama crazy as hell. You ain't done with your daddy. He crazy as hell. Come on. You ain't done with your sisters and brothers, your aunties and your uncles. You ain't done with the man or the woman that you with. Come on. You ain't done with the job that's paying you less money. Come on. But as soon as it gets time for the kingdom, we're the only entity that get easy done with so quickly. We're the only portion of life that we can find and change from. You cannot excommunicate yourself from this world for paying taxes, but you can excommunicate yourself for paying tithes in church, going to church. Isn't that funny? Mm-hmm. Tell me any law that can stop you from paying taxes.
Mm-hmm.
Come on. Because when you go to the store, unless you live in Delaware, which is the first state of our union, our country, there's the only state, Delaware is the first state, and the only state that don't pay taxes. Yo, Dr. Celeste Washington lives in the chief pastor out there in Delaware. And I said, she said, you gotta come here, brother. I said, why? She said, you know, we don't pay taxes here. So how do y'all survive? tell them we have other things that, that covers it. But we don't pay taxes because we're the first state.
Well, they're one of the strongest military places in the United States.
Yeah.
Delaware.
But they pay no taxes there. But here's the key. You may not pay taxes there. But when you go across to New York, to Connecticut, when you go across to other little towns and states, you don't pay taxes. Go get some gas. Go get a bubble gum. Come on. Go get something. You cannot excommunicate yourself from paying taxes. Get on an airplane. Oh, you got taxes after taxes after taxes. And guess what? The flight is cheaper if we didn't have to pay all them taxes for the airport.
Right.
And then guess what? Now they're making us pay taxes for Atlanta, and they'll pay taxes for the place where you go to. But that airport is like, oh my God, come on. Are you serious? Right? So you cannot excommunicate yourself from the political arena of this world at all. So you should not be able to excommunicate yourself from the body of Christ. How is it that you are a believer and say that it's easy for me to excommunicate myself from the body of Christ and yet call yourself a leader? And when it's time to leave, not think that that's going to be sown reaped among you. Wisdom said, no, no, baby, watch what you do. Because to the next place that I call you to, the next place that God called you, remember what you do here. It's going to matter when you get over there.
That's right.
Let me tell you something. I have never in ministry out of 37 years have done the stuff that I see get done in the body of Christ. And sometimes I sit back and say, okay, God, I don't think you're fair to us. No, God, no. We didn't sow this here. This right here, we didn't sow. I don't know where this come from, God. We didn't sow this right here. Are you hearing me? And I say, God, why are we reaping this? We didn't sow this. Why are we reaping this? And it goes back to the fact that some things we will reap. No. I'm sorry. Let me say it with the Spirit of the Lord give it to me. Some things are not a reaping. Some things are imposing. Mm. Some society job, the weight of the world job is to impose their life on us. And to cause us to become embedded with their theology or their ideology and philosophy of what life is. And God says, so some things are not a harvest for y'all want. Or not what you, it's not a harvest for you because you didn't sow that. It's not your reaping. It's the imposing of the satanic world. They want you to break your rank. So he had me look back to Daniel's 7th chapter. He said, Satan is trying to weigh out the saints of the Most High by changing times and dividings of time. I wish I had a leader in here could hear that. I wish I had a preacher on this live could hear that. Benito, RJ, Phyllis, y'all in this room, I want y'all to hear this. I want y'all to hear this. Hear this. Hear it. The job of the enemy is to wear us out by changing and dividing of time. Wow. And what we got going on today. Okay, Beard Budweiser on Milwaukee Best. Some beard had a transgender girl on the cane, right? Right? Huh? Budweiser had a transgender. Society says, I don't care what is legal. We're not going to drink your beer with a transgender on it. So they recall the cans back. They recall all those cans because society said, we're not going to do it. We got tired of Donald Trump. What did we do? We went down there to that doggone voting booth and got rid of him. Isn't it funny that when we don't like something, we can get rid of it? But when we're in the body of Christ, we can't stand together and destroy the works of the enemy. I want y'all in this room to know y'all watching me alive. Y'all are not my enemy.
That's right.
Y'all are not my enemies, and I'm not your enemy. Y'all are not my enemies, and I'm not your enemy. The thief coming to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But that word thief simply means false teacher. So that everybody say that with me. The word thief means in its original text, false teacher. The false teacher comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. But Jesus said, I come that you can have life. Huh? And it's more abundant. False teachers come to steal, to kill, and destroy. I'm not your enemy. You're not my enemy. We're part of the body of Christ. And whether we like it or not, we still got to work in the kingdom.
That's right. Amen.
And we still got to do it together. Yeah. Oh, how, Psalms 133. Oh, how pleasant it is for brothers to dwell together in unity. Now, I'm going to close with this right here. We're going to stay on wisdom. And we're going to stay on the oil of God. Right? We're going to stay on wisdom. We're going to stay on the oil of God. But I want to share this with you. The wisdom. Share this with you. Psalms 133 says, oh, how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together. Do you think that the false teachers want us to dwell together?
No.
He wants to come and bring division.
Right.
Wait a minute. But before division comes in, he brings out busy schedules. Listen to me, America. Before division comes, he gets you overloaded with stuff so that he can divide. Because he knows you got wisdom, he can't come directly to you. So what he does is pour into you, overload you with stuff to make you become absent from what it is that you need to have. And then he divides. Okay, he's a wise serpent and cunning craft. That enemy he ain't no punk. He got some master skills. He's so masterminded that he made what? Eve do what? And Adam do what? And then they both said, we naked. And then God said, what? Who told you? Because I didn't tell you he was naked. You see that? Watch this. What God pulled out of Adam made Adam miss what God made him become.
Wow.
I fight every day of my life not to miss what the Father. Listen, ladies and gentlemen, brothers and sisters, guys and gals, kings and queens, bees and butterflies. I want to encourage y'all tonight that God is amazing. I want you to open your mouth and say wisdom.
Wisdom.
Wisdom is experience.
Wisdom is experience.
Knowledge.
And good judgment.
Listen, people of God, those of you that's watching us on the live, those of you that's in this room, we are at the most greatest hour of our life. It's because our Heavenly Father has set aside a handpicked of us to pour wisdom and oil into us. The best part of the kingdom of God is Bible class and Sunday school. Worship ain't the best part. That's just the church going boom. But Sunday school and Bible class is the most effective part of the body of Christ and in the body of Christ. So I encourage you to continue to learn the word of God, set the strength of self approved that a workman need not to be ashamed, rightly dividing the words of truth. I love each and every one of you. Be encouraged, be empowered, and go in peace. And remember this, that the wisdom of God has eyes, it has ears, it has a heart, it has feet, it has hands. But today, wisdom is watching over you. God bless you and God keep you, as my prayer.